Science in Neural Life. I'm Molly and I'm here with a super special guest. This is my advisor, Elena Kramer, who is a professor of organismic and evolutionary biology at Harvard University.
Hi everybody.
In past episodes, we've done some experiments involving genes and DNA and others involving plant anatomy, and today we get to combine the two. We're going to look at where a gene is expressed in a flower bud.
Right, and to do that, we have to do an experiment called in situ hybridization, which allows us to actually localize where the gene is expressed in the flower.
Before we jump in, though, we need to talk about gene expression. The genetic experiments we've done in previous episodes have focused on DNA, and the DNA of these columbine plants is a beautiful instruction manual for how to be a columbine.
Right, but you might be wondering, if they have the same instruction manual in every cell, how does the cell in the leaf know to be a leaf cell and the cell in the petal know to be a petal cell?
And that's because the different parts of this plant aren't all expressing the same genes.
You might be wondering what we talk about when we say expression. And we're really talking about the first step of what we call the central dogma of biology.
The central dogma of biology refers to the flow of genetic information in a cell. The genetic information encoded in DNA is copied into an RNA molecule through a process called transcription. And then the information in that RNA is copied into a protein through a process called translation. When scientists want to figure out which genes are being expressed, they often look at this first step of the central dogma and detect which genes have been transcribed into RNA.
Some genes are transcribed in every cell of the entire plant, but other genes are only transcribed in specific cell types. And those are the genes that tell a leaf cell to be a leaf cell or a petal cell to be a petal cell. And those are the genes we're most interested in as developmental biologists.
So in situ hybridization is a method of visualizing gene expression in an organism's tissue by detecting the presence of that RNA copy of the gene. Today we'll be looking at how the gene histone H4 is expressed in flower buds. And that gene can be expressed anywhere in the plant, but only in cells that are actively dividing. So we want to find out which cells are dividing when over the course of a flower's development. Oh, if you need a refresher about columbine flowers and why we study them, check out our previous episode. The link is up here.
So now we're ready to actually start the experiment. So we have already collected really early flower buds and we've chemically preserved them and we've infiltrated them with wax and we put the plant material and the wax into a little plastic mold, and that allows me to put the tissue that is in the wax onto this machine. So this is called a microtome and it's like the deli slicer of science. And it basically allows us to make really, really thin 8-micron sections of this plant tissue. So like if you were gonna make a sliced pastrami sandwich for your hamster, this is totally what you would use. So now what I wanna do is I'm gonna sit down at the microtome and I'm gonna rotate this wheel, and that is going to move the wax past this really, really sharp blade. Don't touch the blade. So as I turn the wheel, the wax moves past the blade and it cuts little tiny sections of the plant tissue. So now I'm just going to lay those sections on the surface of the water, and as they land on the water, you can see that they just flatten out. And the warmth of the water actually melts the wax just a little bit, and that helps the wax relax. And it's going to allow the sections to sit down really super flat on the surface of the glass slide. Once we're happy with how the sections have flattened out, we can remove the excess water. All right, so now all our sectioning is done, we have to wait for 4 hours while the sections actually adhere to the slides.
So now that the slides are dry, I'm going to put them in this little slide rack for the next steps. Okay. And now we have to get the tissue that's on the slides ready to reveal their gene expression. But to do that, we have to soak them in a hilariously large number of solutions. So these solutions will help dissolve some of the wax, will help get rid of any proteins, and just generally help the experiment go smoother. Thank you. hepatocytes have been through those ridiculous number of solutions, they're ready finally to reveal where they're expressing histone H4. So we've designed a little piece of RNA called a probe that is able to interact with the tissue's copy of histone H4.
Right, so you've got the probe in one tube here, and I'm going to take some of this other solution that's called the hybridization solution. And that's the magical solution that helps the probe actually interact with the RNA that's in the tissue. So I'll mix the two of them together, and then I will spread that mix of probe and hybridization solution on the slides, and then I will sandwich the two slides together so that the sections are facing each other, and that creates this tiny little space where the hybridization actually occurs.
Now you know why this experiment is called in situ hybridization. The probe hybridizes to the plant's own RNA in situ, or in the original place where the gene is expressed. And now it has to incubate overnight so that the hybridization works well. And now it's ready. The purpose of this ridiculous number of solution changes is that we need to wash away any extra probe that didn't hybridize so we're not getting any false signal of gene expression. Now it's finally time to visualize where the probe has hybridized to histone H4. And we can't do this directly, so we have to add an antibody to the slide that will interact with the probe, which will then reveal where the gene is being expressed, just like we used antibodies in episode 4 of season 1.
So we've got all our slides. They've been through all of those solutions. And I'm going to pick up a pair of slides, and I'm going to put them down into this other solution that has the antibody in them, and I'm just going to sandwich them together so that the solution gets drawn up between them. And we're going to let them sit like that for a couple hours and really let the antibody have a chance to attach to the probe. Okay, so now after they have sat in the antibody for a little while, guess what comes next?
Oh, I think a whole bunch of solution changes, but we're pretty sure by now that you know what those look like, so we're going to jump ahead to actually looking at the results of the in situ hybridization.
So in this image, what we're seeing right there is a really, really early flower bud. And every place where you see a little black mark, that represents an individual cell that's undergoing cell division. And you can see that those cells are pretty much everywhere, all throughout this early flower bud. This is a slightly later stage where each one of these little bumps is actually an early petal, stamen, or carpel. And now you can see the cell divisions are concentrated out in those organs. But when we look at the petal, as it starts to develop, initially cell divisions are on throughout the entire organ. But now we want to go to a later stage where the spur is really starting to develop. And so here is that petal. This is a very young petal with an early developing petal spur. And you can see this is where the organ is attached to the flower. All the cell divisions have stopped. And now this is out at the margin of the organ. All the cell divisions have stopped there too. And the cell divisions are starting to stop out here, but they're still really concentrated in the region that's actually going to give rise to the spur. And also over here in an even later stage, you have lots and lots of cell divisions right where the spur is going to initiate. So that tells us something about how the spur actually forms. So now we actually understand where in the flower bud cell divisions are occurring. And in particular, we visualized exactly how the localization of cell divisions promote the development of this totally unusual structure, the petal spur. And now we can combine that data with in situ hybridization of other genes like Molly's going to be doing in her thesis.
That's right. I'll be looking at a lot of other genes involved in petal development, and we're going to be able to use in situ hybridization to know how all of those genes are coordinating to develop this unique organ. And we'll definitely be keeping you posted about that. Thank you so much to our super special guest, Elena Kramer, for appearing on this episode. You can learn more about her research by clicking the link to her lab website in the description. Don't forget to subscribe to Science in Real Life, and we'll see you next time.